I'm on the wave of trying to get everybody to basically live in a purpose and be true to who they are. Like how God sees you, that's how I want you to walk around so everybody else can see you how God sees you. Me and my man, we was at the deli, and we got locked up. Like the cops rolled up and it was like, we looking for somebody with braids, blue shorts, and the white t-shirt, tank top. And me and my homie had the same exact shit on.
So they was looking for him, or they was looking for somebody that was just like both of y'all?
Somebody that was just like both of
us. But it wasn't either one of y'all?
Nah, they was looking for somebody else, and we both got locked up for that shit.
So they looking for one person, caught two people with the same description, and then locked both of y'all up.
And listen, both of us, I'm light-skinned, and he dark-skinned. They like niggas from the streets. You see what I'm saying? The niggas that grab that negative attention, they crave
most
that
of
thrill.
Them want niggas who gonna spend a check on them, and when you get money fast,
that's not even that.
No, I'm saying that's why
that's
you would want a nigga
that's
from
nowadays,
the streets.
Nowadays,
yeah, that's what I'm saying.
But you ain't.
They want a nigga who gonna spend a check on them, and it's easier. Like this is the thing: when you make money fast, you spend money fast. So that's why they be wanting niggas in the streets, because niggas in the streets you make the money faster, but you spend it even faster. You feel me? When a nigga work for himself or is the 9 to 5, you have to put
that's
in the
fact.
Time to make that money. So it's harder for you to spend that much, knowing the hours you put in to make that shit.
What's going on, y'all? This is Twist from Twist Tees. Check me out on the TBH podcast with my man Buck Bandit. We're gonna come at y'all live and direct, hitting y'all with a lot of shit. So come holler at me.
Yeah. Turn me up a little bit. Turn me up a little bit.
We down here with my homeboy Buck Bandit.
Buck Bandit, man, a real rap.
BBTV. Big shout out to all the real niggas. BBTV. I'm off for the base.
Buck Bandit TV, hear me?
Niggas know my Buck. Niggas know he be
filming, shit, and making videos. I got nice pictures in the videos, man.
Niggas don't like him, cause I'm fake.
My nigga Buck Bandit.
My boy Reno, Buck Bandit.
My man Buck Bandit.
Buck Bandit TV.
Yes, sir. Little
BB TV. Easy.
You know what it is, the kid Buck Bandit Reno, and you're tuning in to another episode 4. Of the TBH podcast, man. I be your boy Buck Bandarino, and we got a special guest today. You see the hoodie, you know what I mean? Twist Tees, you know what I mean? But before we get into today's episode, I want to make sure y'all subscribe right now. Subscribe right now on the YouTube, man. All the listeners, check us out on YouTube. All the YouTube watchers, go listen to the audio. We always keep bonus audio, you know what I mean, for y'all to check out. You know what I mean? There's more to come, man. Hope y'all fuck with the last episode featuring my man Twine, man. Shout out to Get Your Weight Up, Twine. But we got my boy in the building today, Mr. Twist Tees. What's going on with you, my man?
What's up with you, my boy?
Oh, you already, man.
How you?
Control that. You got that?
Yeah, I got you.
You know what I'm saying? What's going on with you, man?
Oh, man, you know, just living another day in the black man life, you know?
You know, hustling.
Yeah, hustling.
Creating. I mean, I see you got some more shit on, some new shit.
No, that's old, actually. You know what I'm saying? I made this like 2 years ago.
Fresh and funky.
You know what I'm saying? I just decided to throw it on real quick. Just so, you know what I'm saying?
Fucks with it. Because when I went to go knock on your shit, you was working.
Yeah. I'm in the...
What you working on right now?
I'm in the customizing sneaks now. Like cleaning the sneaks and customizing them and stuff like that.
Okay.
So that's the type of stuff I'm into now. Like trying to expand my business and brand a little bit. You know, I see a lot of people out here, they be doing, you know, different collaborations with like Nike and Adidas, and I'm trying to hit that same wave and trying to be on that same market.
Okay. Yeah, we're going to get into that more, but let the people know, you know what I mean, who you are and exactly what you do. You know what I'm saying? Because you got a lot of shit going on, but you always working. Let them know who you are, what you do, man.
But first and foremost, my name is Twist. I own Twist Tees. I print for myself. I print for other people, as you can see. That's one of my designs. This is one of my designs. I got a bunch of designs that I did. What else do I do? Like I said, I make sneakers. Well, customized sneakers. Clean sneakers. If you got sneakers that you got, you know what I'm saying, dirty, and you need them joints to be restored.
Get them restored, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I do that also now.
Gang.
You know what I'm saying? And a couple other things, you know what I'm saying, I'm trying to get into. Open a little lounge and stuff like that. you know, something for like like artists to come in, you know what I'm saying, express themselves, be who they are. You know, mm-hmm. we don't, in this world today, we don't have a lot of people pushing the narrative the narrative on how to be, you know, yourself. Everybody want to be like somebody else all the time.
And that's real.
That's nutty to me. So
that's real.
I'm on the wave of trying to get everybody to basically live in a purpose and be true to who they are. Like how God sees you.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I want you to walk around so everybody else can see you how God sees you.
I feel that upliftment. You know what I'm saying? And what sparked the flame? I mean, how did you get into wanting to design and all that? You know, come up with your own gear, your own clothing line, and wanting to get in this mindset. What got you into that? Yeah, you know what it is, the kid, Buck Bandit Reno, and I'm here to let y'all know the opportunity is here, man. Buck Bandit Podcast Network now is a Buck Bandit Podcast Network. So if you out there, you looking to shoot your podcast, you don't got a place to shoot it. You don't got video equipment, video editor. You don't got audio equipment, audio editor, lights, microphones. Don't worry about none of that because we'll handle that. You know, hit me up at Buck Bandit Reno on Instagram or Buck Bandit Podcast on Instagram and find out how you can get your own podcast here on the Buck Bandit Podcast Network, man. What are you waiting for? You in the house doing it? You still doing it off your phone? You doing lives? Forget all that. If you in the tri-state area, you in Philadelphia, come get your podcast shot here, man. Hit me up. Once again, at Buck Bandit Reno on Instagram, at Buck Bandit Podcast on Instagram, or you can email me at buckbanditstudio@gmail.com. Let's get it, man. What sparked that flame?
Well, I actually got into like the designing of the clothes when I was doing my music. Merchandise was something that I really wanted to get into, and I knew that with music, you're going to have merchandise when you're doing music.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's how a lot of us start off, is the music. You're like, fuck it, I got to expand. But yeah, go ahead.
So with the music, I got involved with that like that, and then just sitting down and working in Photoshop and shit like that. It was like, damn, I like this.
Mm-hmm.
So I started taking a liking to doing it. Like I started screen printing, and with that, like that joint, like pushed my creativity like far beyond that I ever knew.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So then I wanted to be more mainstream, I guess you could call it.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to do the embroidery. So yeah, I went
something that anybody could, you know, wear from kids to older people.
But now I also seen like the market and like for clothing, like everybody was doing the same thing. Like everybody was doing screen printing at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody was doing vinyl, but nobody was doing embroidery.
Yeah.
So that's what made me
say. They usually go to the warehouses to do it.
Right. Yeah. So that's when I was like, oh, wait, let me switch the game up. Let me do something that ain't nobody doing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what made me start doing the embroidery and stuff like that. So once
that's
I got
smart.
Once
that's
I got smart. The embroidery and I started sewing and stuff like that, that's what made me really, really dive into it like that.
Okay. I feel that, because that's a different way to take. You could have been like, all right, I'm going to do the same thing they doing. You found the flip side. Because usually you got to go to a manufacturer or something to get the embroidery. You right. know, pay them. You don't use it. You can't. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, anybody I know, they usually go to like some type of warehouse deal or some shit like that. So that's good. That's a good flip and a good business mind to have to do that. So what's the type of clothes? What type of designs you got you working on? Wait, did you tell me what inspired? You told me that kind of inspired it when you seen that. Was it a person in there that you was looking at specifically, and you was like, you like that, but you had your own twist to it. You like how I did that?
Great. Nah, the only person that I can say that I truly like felt like inspired me was Ralph Lauren.
Okay,
that's where the beard low came shit. From. Yeah, because like. Growing up, that's all we really wore like was polo. I'm saying we wore other designers, but
yeah,
polo,
but that was the main shit. Right. You get some fresh low any color shirt,
yeah,
you was on.
So like And then with the bear, that the polo bear was such a hit. Like, it made everybody want to, like, wear it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what made me look at it and say, you know, I'm going to create a bear. Like, this was my first bear I created. And I said, I'm going to start my bear off like this. And a lot of people was rocking with it. Like, yo, that joint mean.
Yeah.
But then I also wanted to switch it up and get the designs to be more graphic, like how the polo bears was.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I'm working on right now. Like, I want to have a collection of like 100 different bears, like how polo really does have different bears and different polo outfits. You know what I'm saying? And different, you know what I'm saying? Skiing.
I like the flip that you do. Like, even if you had the same bear, how you flip the colors in the bear. You feel what I'm saying?
And like, that's another thing I like to do, because I seen with polo, it's so uniformed. And everybody can go in there. Regular brown bear
with a different color shirt on or something
Right. Yeah. And everybody can walk in there and have the same opportunity bear. To get the same shirt. So with me,
you get one of a kind type shit.
Yeah. So, and that started from when I got locked up. Me and my man, we was at the deli.
Mm-hmm.
And we got locked up. Like, the cops rolled up and it was like, we looking for somebody with braids, blue shorts, and the white t-shirt, tank top. And me and my homie had the same exact shit on.
So they was looking for him, or they was looking for somebody that was just like both of y'all?
Somebody that was just like both of
us. But it wasn't either one of y'all?
Nah, they was looking for somebody else, and we both got locked up for that shit.
So they looking for one person, caught two people with the same description, and then locked both of y'all up.
And listen, both of us, I'm light-skinned, and he dark-skinned.
So
they just, they said, they didn't know. Round them up. Yep, and they locked both of us up.
So
since then, I said, I don't ever want to look like nobody else.
That'll make you really want to change it.
Yeah, shit. Like, I ain't want to be walking down the street and be like, oh, you fit the description. There's no way in hell I fit the description, because I don't dress like nobody else.
Yeah.
You can't tell me, this is a person in the black hoodie. Nah. It's not this hoodie. It's not these jeans. It's not these sneaks.
Mm-hmm.
It's not this hat. Because I don't wear what everybody else wears.
No, that's real.
I'm the type of person, if I see somebody wearing something that I got, like, I swear I would give it away. I thought I had some rare polo sneaks one time, right? I saw somebody on the train with them Jones. I went home and threw them away.
Yeah.
Because I ain't want them no more.
Yeah.
Ever since that mindset, it just made me say, yo, I can't.
PTSD, man. That shit'll fuck you up.
So
did you had to do time behind it? How long did they hold you for it, though?
No. I mean, the only thing that it did was it made me, like, because I think I had, I got kind of railroad, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't really, like, speak about that too much.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, what I did was I just played no contest, because that, you know, I was a young boy.
So they basically like, look, if you just take this, you can go wash your hands.
Do treatment court,
whatever.
So I was like, all right, fuck it. Like, and that joint.
But what was it that they was trying to make you plead to? What was it that they was making you plead to?
I think it was weed. Yeah, it was weed.
But when they got you, it wasn't for that.
They ain't catch nothing on me. They ain't catch nothing on either one of them.
But what I'm saying, when they originally got y'all, it was for somebody who fit the description who did what?
So made a drug sale.
That made a drug sale.
Yeah. So now, I'm not saying that I wasn't out there selling drugs.
No. But I'm just saying. That's what I'm saying. But it was one person. But they locked both of y'all up.
Yeah.
And gave both of y'all the same type deal. But they was supposed to get.
I don't know what.
You don't know what happened with him.
I don't know what happened to my man, John, because they separated that shit. So, like whatever happened with his, it happened with his. Like,
he got locked up?
Yeah, he got locked up. He didn't do no time or no shit like that. I think he, like, I don't really know. I don't want to speak on that, John, because I don't know
the facts. I got you.
But I know for me, like, my lawyer was just like, listen, man, just
plead to this and get
the
fuck out.
Yeah, you get treatment court, whatever. So I'm sitting in fucking rehab, and I didn't smoke none of this at the time. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, now, like I said, I was selling drugs at the time, but they didn't catch it on me.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. And I know for a fact they wasn't coming for me. I know the person they was coming for. Mm. So I know for a fact that it wasn't for me, because me and my mans in the, we was down there gambling.
Okay.
So ain't nobody make no type of transaction. You see what I'm saying? So yeah. I made a crazy move. Like, I don't really tell the story, but like, we was down there gambling and motherfuckers had cops rolled up. And I seen it and I walked off and I had like some crack on me and I like in my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
So like, and this is a statute of limitations, so I could talk about this shit. So I had it in my pocket. So I took it out and it's like, they was like, yo, come back here. And I turned around and like had him up like behind like this.
Mm-hmm.
And there was like some bushes right there. Mm-hmm. So tossed the shit in the joint.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, me? They like, yeah. I'm like, all right. So as I was walking up, I just tossed that shit and walked back over there. So like, the only thing they like found on me was like 200, like 250 or some shit like that.
Just money?
Yeah. It was just,
man, they can't do shit with money.
You're right. But being that they was looking for somebody who, quote unquote, fit the description.
Okay.
That supposedly had served the CI or whatever. I'm like, man, I know I didn't do that. My man know he didn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
We know who did it. But, you know, it is what it is.
You calling the wrong time, wrong place. Yeah. Right time, wrong place.
Yeah, so, you know.
For them. Shit.
That shit right there, that was like, I'll never go do that.
You know, they don't give a fuck. They just want, they just need to bring somebody down. Everybody get paid for just getting your name on it.
Oh, man. These, you know? These cops back in the day, man, it was nothing. I mean, big time nothing. They locked six people up one time for one person. I said, damn, yeah. I was one of the six.
Mm.
That shit was nutty.
Yeah. Philly ain't no joke with that shit, man.
No, Philly. These Philly cops back in the day like that.
It's still crazy, though.
It was them same cops that locked up Meek and railroaded him back in the day. They were the same task force as narcotic ass unit that was running around here doing a bunch of bullshit. Because the narc boy came into the crib and was like, I know you. You the boy who got the white Louis V shoes on upstairs. Man, just tell me about the murders that's going on around here. Who doing the shootings, man? And I'll let you go. I said, what? I'm sitting there saying to myself, man, this dickhead. First of all, those shoes don't even fit me.
Yo, you know they said, I think the cop that the unit that you got. That you said Meek got caught by.
Yeah.
They was they turned up
corrupt, dirty,
corrupt and shit, and all that.
Listen,
you know what I'm saying? So
them cops took bags of money. Well, bags of clothes, my bad. Bags of clothes out the crib.
But that shit ain't on your, any that money, shit still on your record?
Nah, I beat that joint.
Oh, alright. So
I beat that joint.
But if you didn't, nigga, you would have had a case against that motherfucker. Some
man in the courtroom, man, the judge, I'm not the judge, the fucking, the detective, whatever, the narc boy, he was on the stand telling me something. Oh, yeah, you said you lived here. I mean, I ain't never, nigga, I never said anything to you.
Yeah.
Nigga, you wanted to implicate me into doing all this extra shit. I know who you are. And nigga, you don't know me, bro.
Yeah, like I work. Flip it.
Like I was working for the welfare to work program at the time, bro.
Mm-hmm.
Like I wasn't doing no fucking drug dealing. Like I was done with that shit at the time. Like that shit was a wrap for me. I was like, man, I'm not. I saw my brother get. No, I didn't see my brother get killed. My brother got killed in the streets. I wasn't going to be a victim.
Rest in peace. Say his name.
James, my brother James.
Rest
Wooder.
In peace.
R.I.P. Wooder.
Buck Bandit P here to tell y'all once again, fresh buck gear is in. So make sure y'all copping up on that buck gear. We got it from the adult sizes all the way down to the kids sizes, shirts, hoodies, all kind of flavors, custom colors, whatever you need. Just make sure y'all get at us. You hear the phone is popping right now for this new buck gear. So make sure y'all get at us. Follow us on the Instagram at Buck Bandit Clothing, or you can follow us on Twitter at Buck Clothing, or hit us up on that email. That's buckbanditclothing@gmail.com. You already know what it is. Let's get it. But
me and my partner had a music studio out in, you heard the Grindhouse Studios?
Yeah, I used to, I used to record up there back in the day.
In Port Richmond, yeah. We had a joint up there. Then I started doing the clothes, and I was working. I was like, man, fuck this job shit, man.
And that's when you started going hard at that shit?
Yeah, I was already, you know what I'm saying, like, doing shit. Like, I was doing little pop-ups at my job and shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, they had little vending days. I would come there.
Bring some shit.
Yep. Like, I'd be working upstairs and come downstairs and set up and be working there and then, like, go from there and then that's be hustle, working at bro. Night. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, I would get up. My kids wouldn't see me until, like, sometime during the weekend. And that was rarely, unless, like, I made it, like, my business to make sure that I always spent a day or two with them.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
How many kids you got?
I got two.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when you was doing this, you already had both of them?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I had both of them little crazy ones.
I mean, how's the how's it with the kids and all that? You how is it like managing your time and managing your hustle?
Well, both of my kids are like teenagers. My oldest is about to be 18, and my youngest is about to be 15. So they don't really like need much of my time.
Too much. I mean, when you started, how old were they?
When I started,
mm-hmm.
they wanted my time. Mm-hmm. Like, so it was hard. Like, I would like had to go do a little custody battle with my daughter's mom
mm-hmm.
because I was working so much and my daughter was home with my ex and my daughter didn't really like being there and shit like that. So she was like, I didn't want to be here if my dad not here. So like, I was forced to really leave. That's what really made me leave my jobs, because the fact that I was about to lose my daughter. And I was like, all right, well, I got to figure something out.
You had to weigh it out.
Yeah.
The job and the kid, or the hustle and the kid.
Right.
And so you wasn't about to stop that motherfucking hustle.
Nah, because at the time I was in a relationship. So like, we was like hand in hand with that shit, which I thought, you know what I'm saying? But
at the time.
Yeah, at the time. But right now it's just like, you know what I'm saying? You got to still do what you got to do. I was selling drugs since I was 9 years old. Not something that I'm proud of
glorifying,
saying. You know what I'm saying? But like, that's something that I was forced to do. Like,
man, Philly is so, it's so, I don't know how it is in other places, but in Philly, it's so easy to get your hands on that faster than it is to get a job, bro.
But see, like, back in the day, like, certain people, like, certain old heads will put you into a position to do
that shit.
And it's not like I wanted to do that. It was like you was forced to. I was forced to run and do this and do that. Like, I didn't want to do that shit. You know what I'm saying?
Mm.
Like, I didn't really want to do that shit. I was a kid. You know what I'm saying? And a foster kid at that. So it's like, you know what I'm saying? You got to get in how you fit in around here. I was always, you know what I'm saying? Since a young boy, I was always told, like, yo, you got to get what you can, how you can. You know what I'm saying?
While you can.
Yeah. Like, me and my little brother, we used to walk, because we used to live right there on 55th and Elmwood. We used to walk right up the street every day from school. I mean, before we went to school. Right there on 58th Street. You know where that little recycling joint is at?
Mm-hmm.
We used to walk up there, but back in the day, it was like, I think it was like 7 or 8. Walk up there and ask people for money. Like, black guys, white guys, whoever. Most of the time, it would be like a black guy would give us like $5, $10. You know what I'm saying? We'll go school or a store, get something to eat, because mom wasn't around, dad wasn't around. It was just us.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? Like, we had holes in our sneaks. Like, socks was like folded up 4 or 5 times because that's how long they was.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, smelling like piss and, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's not something that, you know what I'm saying, like, a kid should have to go through at that. You know what I'm saying? But that's the shit that made me the individual that I am now.
Yeah.
Because it's like, listen, man, like, I seen the struggle, and my kids understand, like, all right, listen, you got to work for what you want, because everything ain't gonna always come to you. You know what I'm saying? Like, nothing is given to you in this world. And I ain't grow up with no trust fund or no responsible individual at the time to sit back and say, listen, this is, you know what I'm saying?
A lot of us is first generation. I think our generation is first generation hustlers because a lot of our parents had different struggles where it wasn't as easy for them to get to the hustle as it is for us. You know what I'm saying? Not making excuses for it because, you know what I'm saying, I'm the first person in my family to go to college, finish it, and all that shit through all the people that's in my family.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Fortunately, you know, I used to do shit back in the day, but fortunately, I never got caught for nothing. You know what I mean? I stopped in time. You know what I mean? I told myself I wasn't going to do that no more. I was going to go with the ups and downs of my business. That's the only way I'm going to know if I'm succeeding in it. You know what I'm saying? Because it's easy for, I can make a call and get anything. You know what I'm saying? It's harder to do the right thing.
Now, that's, you know what I mean? That's a fact because, like, they make it harder for you to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's so easy, like you said, to jump back out there and just, you know what I'm saying, grab whatever. And
with you, all the shit you got to go through to get a job, you got to make an appointment. You got to fill out an application. Mm-hmm. You got to do an interview. You got to wait till they call you or wait till they ready. If you wanted to fucking make some money right now selling drugs, all you got to do is make one fucking phone call. And you might not even have to pay for it. You could probably get fronted depending on who you call.
Depending on who you are. You know what I'm saying? Like, you definitely can get whatever you want. But that interview for a job, bro, like, that shit be nutty. They'll tell you, like, come in for an interview. You come in and you'll give your best answers to what you think that they want to hear.
And you still don't get it.
And still don't get it based off of, you know what I'm saying, oh, your hair or your complexion. Or
yo, I didn't have people tell me I was too qualified before. Like, yeah, you got something like, why you want to work here? Look at your resume. It's like, yep, because I need a fucking job. Why else would, yep, I apply here?
Yep. See,
dickhead.
Me and my partner just had a conversation like that the other day. And I was telling her, like, on my resume, like, right now, like, if I want, I'm looking for a job because, like, you, I need another stable income, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, now when you go out there, my resume says owner.
So they automatically going to feel like they're going to have to pay you more.
But listen,
they're not going to hire you if they got to pay you more, too.
Not only that, but my resume itself, based off the jobs that I had, I didn't have no slouch ass jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you don't got McDonald's or teller at AT&T or no shit like that. Like, I got director, I got manager, I got shift, you know what I'm saying, mm-hmm, foreman. That's what you got, and owner. Mm-hmm. So it's high title positions, and mm-hmm, I've worked on positions for years when I was working. So I'm not no slouch. So even my former boss, he was like, listen, I said, yo, take me to one of your one of your other sites. He said, I can't take you there. I said, why not? He said, because you cost too much.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Like, so when you know, I knew a woman when I was working at the Welfare to Work program. She had a bachelor's degree, and she still couldn't get a job.
Because they got to pay her too much. When you got degrees and shit like that, or you got experience like that.
No, not a bachelor's. I'm sorry. It was a master's. She had a master's.
Yeah.
And she was on welfare.
Yeah. Because every job at the time she probably was going for, more than likely, she got too much experience, and they're going to have to pay her.
They
got to
pay her.
They don't want to pay you when they can get somebody who don't know nothing about this, pay them the minimum, because they probably going to quit in a certain amount of months and keep that in rotation.
Listen.
You know what I'm saying?
A lot of these jobs is predicated off of people losing the job within 6 months. Because, yeah, a lot of these,
because they never get past that first trial period where they get the
it's not that even real that pay. A lot of these jobs is subsidized through the government.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? So, like, you got a joint called subsidized and unsubsidized. And they probably don't really speak about this too much, but that's what's going on, like, in the Welfare to Work program, right? You got subsidized work and unsubsidized work. Subsidized work means the government pays half of the salary for this employee,
mm-hmm,
up to 6 months. And after that, now the employee has to take on the rest of the salary.
Mm.
unsubsidized is the employer has to pay all of that.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying? So yeah. When you got these subsidized workers, now, yeah, they expendable. They only here for 6 months. And then we're going to come in here because we only paying, yeah, this joint can be $16 an hour. But you break that thing down, what's that? $8.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the company only paying you $8 an hour.
Yeah. And I would say the other part because a company I work for, if you ain't get past that first 60 to 90 days, you ain't get that company boost because they usually pay you a certain amount for those that amount. And once they sign you on, they have you sign some paperwork.
Then you got
after the 60 days, then they give you the real pay starting that next check.
But that's when they're liable for more. Now you get them.
They're not liable in the first 60.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh yeah, get that work piece. All right, you come in. You get that work piece. They never have to get to that. So yeah, that's real.
That's what be going on.
That's what temp services be for you, though.
But temp services be gassing people.
Oh, didn't see you sitting there. What you doing there, man? What you doing here? I know why you here. You want studio time. Well, lucky you. We down here during the corona times, and as long as you got your mask and disinfect it, come on down, man. $40 an hour, $100 for 3 hours, $180 for 5 hours, man. Management deals, monthly deals, whatever you need. Come on down to Buck Bandit Studio, man. Now get out of here, man. Get out of here before I catch that Rona.
Like the joint I ain't gonna lie, the joint I used to work for, I used to be caking on that joint.
Yeah, but they was caking off of you.
Shit, that was cool. I was getting the double time, triple time and shit and all that. You know what I mean? Shout out to American Staffing.
Great. Most staffing agencies, I believe, they get double the pay.
If they did, it was well worth it. Cause you know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, I used to stack up from there. I don't even remember where the fucking money. If you ask me what I bought, where the money is right now, I couldn't even tell you.
But just imagine this. Just imagine if you got that job without the staffing agency and got paid whatever the staffing agency.
Oh, matter of fact, when they wanted to hire me, they asked, did I still want to work through the staffing agency or did I want to work with them? Mm-hmm. They was going to pay me $2, $3 less. So I said, no, I'm going to stay with the staffing agency.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. Through the staffing agency, I was getting $16 an hour. They was going to pay me like $13.50,
$14. Mm. See, that's nutty.
Yeah. So the staffing agency was getting them, nigga.
Damn, they was getting
sick. Like I said, shout out to American Staffing.
Good money then. There's no way in hell the motherfuckers was paying that. But see, that could have been.
And they was giving me double time. When they were like, yo, anybody want to work, we'll give you double time. Boom, we'll work Saturday or something. Anybody want to work, we'll give you a double time and a half if you want to work on something. Oh, we in there, nigga.
But see, like, that's what I'm saying. That's where the subsidized working is coming in at. Because the employee is paying half of their salary.
Hey, shit, look, it worked for me at the time. I don't know what that shit meant.
And then the double time, now now you just getting the full salary. So if you getting, if they only paying $8, and then now you doing double time, now you getting the full 16 that they was going to originally give you.
So they was giving me 16, the real work, the real job for cleaning out a warehouse, just doing boxes was 32 an hour.
No.
That's what I'm trying to say. That's what they was fucking giving. Like, if you work the extra time today, we got an extra 4 or 5 hours. You want to work that, we give you double time. We was already getting 16. That's what I'm saying.
But listen to what you said, though.
Yeah.
You said when they went to hire you full on,
No, that's what they trained. Well, when we finished that building, they moved us to a different place because I'm still with the temp agency. And the main place, that was just a project that the main place had, because they had to dump out the
contract.
Yeah,
so that contract was paying. Yeah, 16.
That contract through the temp agency. When I went over to the building after that contract was done,
the other contract was paying.
But my shit was still 16 and never went down.
Right.
But when they wanted to hire me on to the building without the temp agency, then they wanted to pay me 14.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Because now they only kicking out the extra. At first they wasn't paying the whatever. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like they was giving you
It was a project.
Yeah, they was giving you half. Half of whatever they was giving you was coming from somebody else. So now when they hire you.
Because it was a project hire.
Right, but now when they hire you, listen, you only getting $14. They was paying you $16, but we was only paying $8 of that.
Yeah, be like, guess what? I'm staying with them. You know what I mean? And I'm still going to work here. Right. You know what I'm saying? No, but that shit makes sense, though. I never thought of that shit like that. So, yeah, them temp agencies is just like, they managers, bro. That's it. We're going to bring you in, manage your career real quick. We're going to get our cut, but we're going to make sure you get paid.
They case managers.
Yeah.
That's all they are.
I fucks with that. You know what I'm saying?
That's what... Like I said, like welfare to work programs and stuff like that, workforce, work ready, all them programs. That's what they all do. You know what I'm saying? They help people get jobs and, you know what I'm saying, they get tax credits and stuff like that. Because a lot of, you know what I'm saying, companies get tax credits also. Like if you on, especially if you get like welfare or some shit like that. If you get welfare, you get that TANF credit. You gonna get some type of benefit like crazy, you know what I'm saying? Because that shit be like, oh, you get unemployment. I mean, you get welfare. Oh yeah, come on. You know what I'm saying? You get a tech. The company gets a tax break by hiring people who are, let's just say, ex convicts or welfare recipients.
So you would think they would hire more of them. You would think that.
They do.
Where?
They do.
I mean, they got certain places, but a lot of places won't hire you with a record.
I mean, depending on where you at, but I know a lot of people who got records and got jobs.
Yeah, they got them. Without going through a program?
I don't know if they went through a program or not, but I know my brother, he's a supervisor at PPA.
Oh, that's lit.
Yeah, and then my other brother, he works. Now I think he went through a union or something like.
Some people got to have it.
Yeah, and both of them niggas been in jail like crazy. So I know, like, you know what I'm saying, you can get jobs with.
Oh, all right, see, ain't no excuses out there. Man.
Nah, it's
if
not.
Y'all out there, oh no, they won't hire me because my record.
Nah,
they
your record, hire me. Your record more than likely gonna help you, especially after you done did your time. If you done did your time. And it's not no, like, real violent crime, and you ain't working around no kids and no shit like that, you more than likely going to get that job because most of the time they're getting help from the government to pay your salary.
To hire you. So they probably get paid extra just to hire you.
Right. You see what I'm saying? So that's what I'm trying to let you know.
Game.
Like, yeah, so when you a regular person, you're like, and you like what they say, the regular Joe. If you're a regular person, you like
the average
really
Joe.
The average Joe. You really got the odds stacked against you. You either want to be be a villain or you gonna be a good guy. You want to be the Joker or you want to be Batman? and that's what's going on. Batman might seem cool, but fucking Joker gets a lot of attention and. Wins the most. I mean, Joker is
seems though.
Yeah, Joker is the shit. The villains win a lot.
Yeah, it's hard to go against that. It's hard to go against what you're saying because you see that a lot.
Yeah.
A lot of, you know what I mean? It seemed like every couple years the tables turn to fit more of fitting that. So it's like you could keep your shit on the straight path, put out a bunch of good shit. And your shit won't go nowhere. But you do some fuck shit, fuck somebody up or fuck something up.
Yep.
And nigga, your shit gonna pure.
Yeah, because negativity sells faster than positivity.
Oh shit. I did some tests with that. I put a video up and some young bucks fighting some old heads. And that shit got like a million views in like 3 days. That's crazy.
That'd be nutty. Because it'd be like, all right, like a chick could post a picture half naked. And she'll get a million likes. And views. Like, oh my God. But then let her post something up about a business.
Nah, she won't get
that. That shit gonna get shitted on. I'm saying,
fuck that. Say you post all your gear, or I post even this. This shit should get a million views. You know what I'm saying? Like, why is it that the bitch can do the same pose every fucking day? It's not like it's new. You done seen the ass is the same. Y'all nigga, we talked about this on our last episode. Shit. Y'all like, niggas not gonna hit, bro.
Yo, no, listen.
You liking her pic ain't getting you closer to hit.
Listen. I was scrolling through Instagram the other day, right? And I was looking at this chick and I was like, oh shit, she got a fat ass.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was swipe. Oh my God. Bitch, your ass is flat as all hell.
The angles
made this bitch ass look like that. You know how many pictures, bubble.
You know how many pictures they took to get those slides?
Bro, listen. I looked at her. I was like, damn. This bitch had a little cake. I was like, sheesh.
Catfished the shit out you.
Catfish ain't the word, bro. Mm-hmm. I was sitting there looking like, oh, my Lord. That thing pancake. Is a pancake.
It's a cake, all right. A pancake.
Them angles be crazy, bro. They be hitting them angles on that joint, be nutty, and everybody be in that joint. Oh my God. Yeah, nigga, she ain't gonna let you hit.
She not gonna let you hit.
They be sitting up there, oh, promo. Oh, they fake influencers. Man, first of all, half of y'all dead inside. That's why y'all posting those half naked fucking pictures. Yeah.
And make them feel better.
You know what I'm saying?
Having a bunch of comments with the people saying they want to fuck, make them feel better.
And then call the niggas thirsty and stalkers when they do it. All oh, you man, you thirsty.
You what showing you, your ass.
You, yeah, what like, what supposed you want them to do? Like, come on. You out there throwing yourself out there to the sea of fish and want these motherfuckers not to come and take the bait. Like, what the?
Would Dave Chappelle say, you might not be a hoe, but you sure you're wearing a hoe's uniform?
You definitely be having some hoe tendencies.
He says, like chicks. Me going out in the park and not with a cop uniform on and a nigga rob you and you come up to me and say, officer, I need help. He just robbed me. And I say, just because I got on this uniform doesn't make me an officer. Like, bitch, you a hoe. If you on there showing your ass and all that, the attention you gonna get is niggas who wanna touch that ass.
Yep.
Who wanna fuck that ass.
Yep.
That's the energy you putting out.
Yep.
You know
what I mean? And then be mad and upset.
And then you're not an influencer. How the fuck are you what are you influencing? More ass showing?
Yeah, that's what I be saying. Like, but see, this the thing. Like, niggas move off of what females like. So if a female like if a female likes something, these niggas is gonna fucking love that shit. For instance, The Dior Sauvage, that's a great smell. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of females love that. Now a lot of niggas, oh man, the bitches love this. The bitches gonna be on my dick when they smell this. Yeah,
buy that just to put that on.
Yeah, you impressing females like y'all.
You know that's what they out of game though. Like, mm-hmm.
But the thing is, like, you gotta walk around and do this and do all this extra shit just to catch a female's attention when half of these females don't really want to deal with nobody like us because they like these, I'm not even going to say none of that niggas. They like niggas from the streets. You see what I'm saying? The niggas that grab that negative attention, they crave
most
that thrill.
Most of them want niggas who going to spend a check on them. And when you get money fast.
That's not even that.
No, I'm saying that's why that's you would want a nigga from
nowadays,
the streets.
Nowadays.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
But you ain't.
They want a nigga who gonna spend a check on them, and it's easier. Like, this is the thing: when you make money fast, you spend money fast. So that's why they be wanting niggas in the streets, because niggas in the streets, you make the money faster, but you spend it even faster. You feel me? When a nigga work for himself or is the 9 to 5, you have to put
that's
in the time to make that money. So it's harder for you to spend that much, knowing the hours you put in to make that shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? If I made $100,000 a day, it's nothing to spend $20,000 on you. Mm-hmm. But nigga, if I worked all week, I put in all these hours, I had to make my clothes, press them up, I had to do this, I had to go show up, I had to promote, I had to fucking make hand-to-hand to these many people, put all those hours in, lose sleep, see my kids twice in the last 3 days, 4 days, and all that shit. Mm-hmm. Nigga, when a motherfucker say, yo, spend $20,000, you're like, oh, nigga, hold up. For what?
For what?
What am I getting back?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So that's what I mean.
But that's a different form of hustling.
But that's what I'm... But what I'm saying is, it's more time into that, so you're not gonna... I think it's less likely a nigga... Because when you said a female is rather date a street nigga other than a nigga that would be like an entrepreneur that's like us, that's putting in the time and the work, is because they can they make it faster, so they spend it faster.
I get it.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
When you put the time in for the money, you're not going to be easily. You're not going to spend like that. Bitch, I just had to put in 12 days straight to make this.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Where he just made you spend the coke and all that, you can make that shit in 2-3 days.
But the risk is much higher. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You can die any fucking day. Yeah. A nigga can hate on you and grab your shit. And if it's drug related, won't nobody even investigate. You know what I'm saying?
The risk is higher no matter what you're doing.
Anytime the risk high, though, the reward high, the risk is usually high.
The risk is higher no matter what you're doing when you're making a lot of money. Period.
No, but when you go out there, when you're in the streets, when it's illegally documented, it's way harder. Man, listen, I mean, it's easier to make it. It's harder to contain that shit. Now,
some of these, you know what I'm saying, big name motherfuckers is getting taxed for whatever reason.
But a lot of them big name niggas that you saying that's getting robbed and shit, them they shit insured, niggas. So it's like, it's not like they really losing. They probably getting more money back than what it's worth.
I mean, we would hope that's insured.
I would think so. I'm not. Why would you buy a fucking chain worth a house and you ain't insured? That's the dumbest shit ever.
Hey, man. Some niggas don't, that shit don't even be real.
You know what I mean?
I mean, some of them niggas don't be having that shit don't be really
real. Well, for the ones that do got the real
shit. The ones that got that real shit, like, I'm pretty sure that shit is insured.
If it's not insured, they dumb as fuck.
You know what I'm saying? Like when Kim got robbed or whatever, they said that shit was insured. You know what I'm saying? I'm pretty sure. You better get that shit insured. You put a lot of motherfucking money out there on this
shit. Anytime you pay anything high price for your shit, you better have that shit insured. That shit not a game. You know what I mean? You still walking. If you got hundreds of thousands in your account, shit, if you got tens of thousands in your account and you still moving on some street shit, it's something wrong with you. If you ain't figure out a way how to flip that yet, so you don't have to. It's as simple as getting a building and renting out space. You feel me?
But a lot of people don't got that mindset, unfortunately.
And that's that's the fucked up thing.
Like a scenario right now that'll be booming right now. If just say you got 10 big drug dealers that all sell weed. We're not going to call them drug dealers. 10 people that sell weed, right?
Mm-hmm.
They all put their money together. And they go get a dispensary. And then they legally make money for what they selling.
Yeah, and get chains everywhere.
Illegally right now.
Yeah, you can get chains in them joints everywhere.
Bro, you can get them everywhere.
But you know, if we talking about Philly, you know that's not going to happen because niggas don't want to see niggas win before them. It's not that niggas don't want to see niggas win. They just don't want to see them win before them.
Well, unfortunately... You know, it's going to take, not for a nigga to do this, it's going to take, like I say, unfortunately, it's going to take a white person to actually formulate this type of movement to happen. Because you ain't going to be able to walk into anywhere with 10 black people and say, we all got, let's just say, $100,000.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And willing to invest in some type of weed where they still locking black people up for weed.
I seen something
right now, you know, in Jersey, they said all of the licenses for the dispensaries has been given to white people. And I think it's maybe one black person. And that's a maybe.
We gotta look that up.
And that's the crazy thing. And Jersey just like became recreational last year.
Yeah, and you know they're gonna be the first ones on it anyway. Once they make it recreational, the white people was already waiting and shit. More black people coming.
They already winning, bro.
I'm telling you,
They did a documentary on this, John. It was only one black person, and that was some black lady. She was Obama's aide.
Mm-hmm.
That's how she was able to get.
Hers?
Yeah, into the licensing for a dispensary.
Okay.
And she said her brother, he got locked up for marijuana charges before, and he couldn't even work inside the dispensary. Like, if you got locked up for anything...
Oh, so he owned it, but he can't be in it.
No, he was a part of it.
Okay, but he can't be in it.
He couldn't even work in there. He was just like a worker. Like, she was going to let him manage it. Mm-hmm. But you got to understand, a lot of black people are growers and shit like that. Mm-hmm. So, like, they should absolutely be able to be out there and be, like, feeding off of this monster that is marijuana right now.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Shout out to Fly Trap Gumbo, bro. Like, that's somebody right now, a black boy. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He out there winning off of that shit, bro. And then you got people like Jay-Z that's backing him. And then you got the Migos that's in the game and Wiz and Snoop and even Mike Tyson.
I was about to say, you can't forget Mike Tyson.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to Beanie Siegel. He got that Bully Gumbo. Oh, yeah. He just dabbed into that shit.
Yeah. That Bully Gumbo. That joined some gas, too.
I got to get some more of that shit.
Yeah. Yeah, but they need to let more black people in the door when it comes to that, because right now,
more than that,
it's
sports and all that shit.
Well, listen, man,
they holding us back from everything.
Ownership is not something that they're gonna give you in most sports right now anyway, especially in the NFL. Maybe parts of, well, NBA, it's not even maybe bit. There are parts of the NBA you can buy, because you got Jordan who got a team.
Yeah, then Dwayne Wade got parts of got parts of Utah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's dope. I know they said Will Smith had parts of the Sixers. Usher had parts of the, I think it was the Hornets.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
So that's love, man. We out here and it's moving, man. Just as long as we stay on the hustle, and hearing your story is like, you know, it's similar stories around. Everybody got their own unique story. But the great thing about your story is it's still going. You know what I mean? You still writing that shit. You know what I mean?
I tell everybody all the time, the story is best. The story is definitely better than the win. People going to look for the story and can replay that story over and over.
Yeah, related to themselves, too.
You're going
to
celebrate the win one time.
Mm-hmm.
One time you get to celebrate the win, but you can relive the story over and over and over again.
Yeah.
And that's what I continue to tell myself and people around me.
Yeah. And y'all need to tell yourself that too.
Yeah. The story is what people. That's a great saying. The story is what people going to remember you by.
For sure.
Not nothing else.
And, you know what I mean? It's been a great episode, though. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to have you on again, because we only touched the surface and shit. This is just like, you know, a nice little introduction and shit.
Appreciate that.
You know what I mean? But before we get out of this episode, TBH Podcast, you know what I mean? Number 4. Is that number 4? Yeah,
you say number 4.
Number 4. You know what I'm saying? You got anything you want to throw out there? You want to shout out before we sign out of this good old thing?
Yeah, you know what it is. The kid Buck Bandit Reno.
Boy, Buck Bandit Pig.
And we the host of Buck Bandit Podcast, man.
Right,
and if you don't know, we on season 2, man. So if you ain't check us out, man, make sure you check us out, man.
Definitely make sure you check us out, man. Definitely. On all streaming platforms, wherever you get your
podcast. Watch the videos on YouTube.
Right.
You know what I mean? We talk about everything from entertainment, sports, man, all the bullshit going down on the social media, everything.
I mean, if y'all out there doing some crazy shit, don't be doing some crazy shit, but we going to talk about
this. Yeah, yeah. And definitely you can come and watch me, your boy, win 95% of the arguments, too, you know, because I always know everything, you know what I mean?
No, that's some bullshit. I win all the
fucking. He definitely going to win.
Yeah, I want y'all to follow me on my Instagram. It's Papa, P-O-P-P-A underscore Bear, B-E-R. B-E-A-R underscore T.
It's right on your screen.
Yeah, and Twist T's.
How can they get your gear? How can they get in contact with you? Just hit you up on that?
Yeah, but you can go to the website. It's www.twistteesllc.com.
Okay. Okay, they can get more of those. What you got? You got hoodies, you got T-shirts.
We got hoodies, T-shirts. Hats, dresses, jeans. We got more stuff inside. So like,
and you also do custom shit for people who want to do their own shit.
Yeah. So
let them know.
Yeah, if you want to do anything for like a family reunion, graduation,
even your own birthday, clothing line, shit.
Yeah, you got a line for yourself. you starting a business, whatever. If you need help with that, I can take care of all that. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we do hats, embroidery for hats, polos, aprons, towels, whatever. You know what I'm saying? Printing on basically anything that you can name of.
Yeah. So y'all out there, you ready to start your clothing line, your business? This is one stop shop right here.
Yeah.
Right here. So fresh and so clean.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? You see the gear. He got more shit. Make sure you check him out.
Yeah, we got a lot of drip in the shop. You know what I'm saying? You can come 52nd and Grays. 5213 Grays. Suite 218C. Mm-hmm. Come check me out. You know what I'm saying? Appointments only. Appointments only.
Yeah, make sure you hit him up.
Hit that contact button. You know what I'm saying?
You know, make sure you hit him up. He got a lot of gear. I definitely got this custom made. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to Twist Tees. It's the Buck Bandit Podcast Network, TBH Podcast, episode 4. And we out the door. Let's get it.
Peace.
Time for name. Time for front. Time for cuffing. Whoa, whoa, whoa. And time for this, it's time on that. Whoa, time on your. Rewind it back.
Ain't got time for nothing. Ain't got time for friends. Ain't got time for cuffing. But I can make time for loving. Ain't got time for this. Can't waste time on that. Can't waste time on you. Cause I can't rewind it back. Ain't got time for nothing. Ain't got time for friends. Ain't got time for cuffing. But I can make time for loving. Ain't got time for this. Can't waste time on that. Can't waste time on you. Cause I can't rewind it back.
I ain't got time for nothing. Act like you mean more than my grind or something. Act like you been on my mind or something. Yeah, little bitch, you a dime a dozen. She hitting my jack. That shit back to back. You act like my mom.
Yo, just check out another episode of Buck Bandit Podcast. Make sure to subscribe and check out the latest episode right here, y'all. Let's get it, man.
Turn me up a little bit.